What's up? Hang gliding. I'm Ron Gleason, and with me today is John Cranhouse.
We're here to tell you about the wild new sport of hang gliding. It all began over 80 years ago when in 1891, Otto Lilienthal made the first successful flight by man in a glider. He started by jumping from the roof of his barn and landing in a soft pile of hay. Lilienthal, a scientist, logged over 2,000 successful flights, though they were primarily research-oriented.
A far cry from Lilienthal, today's birdmen are involved for the sheer thrill of the sport. While scientists and engineers are more concerned with their SSTs and jumbo jets, hang glider enthusiasts prefer a more natural form of flight. They combined natural flight with new techniques from the space age.
The original shape for these triangular crafts was developed by Dr. Francis Regallo, a NASA engineer. These gliders are named after the good doctor, Regallo wings.
The only thing needed to fly is one of these simple gliders, a hill, and some wind. To launch a glider, face directly into the wind, then run. Under average wind conditions from 5 to 10 miles per hour, 4 or 5 strides is all that's needed to get airborne.
The control of these gliders has been likened to surfing or riding a bicycle. A pilot shifts his weight in the direction that he wants to go. To pick up speed or dive, the triangular control bar is pulled in and the nose goes down. To slow or stall, the bar is pushed out and the nose goes up. To land, the glider is stalled and drops gently earthward. The glider shown here uses ailerons for added control and stability.
Here, a novice pilot gets an added push from his instructor. After a few seconds of smooth and graceful flight, the pilot is ready to land. This is a school of hard knocks. The instructor is quick to inform the pilot of the proper glide path, shown here. Beginning pilots are also informed of the old adage, "Don't fly higher than you're willing to fall."
There are two ways that a flyer can be attached to his craft, either in a seat that is strapped to him, or in a parachute harness so that a flyer is in a prone position. The prone harness offers less wind resistance than sitting in a seat, but it is harder to launch.
Shown here is Dave Kilborn in his Regallo with wheels. Dave doesn't use the wheels to take off or to land, but after landing from a flight that began from the top of a 600-foot hill over half a mile away, he folds up the wings of his kite and then rolls it back up the hill for another flight.
Gliders range anywhere from inexpensive home builds of $60, such as this bamboo bomber with plastic sail, to expensive and intricate craft of mono-wing design costing over $1,000.
Flyers are as different as the crafts that they fly. They range in age from 9-year-old children in their own mini kites to people in their late 70s.
Bob Wills likes to add some excitement to this already exciting sport, hanging upside down. Bob's kite is specially balanced for this hands-off flying, which should never be attempted in an untested glider. Obviously, this stunt should only be attempted by the most proficient of flyers.
Here, Dave Kilborn corners Bob Wills in a mock dogfight. Dave was the first person to foot-launch a Regallo wing about 5 years ago. Bob is an equally proficient flyer in his own right.
Nobody, no matter how hot a flyer, should ever try to fly while another glider is up. Even these 6 very experienced flyers ran into difficulty when the wind suddenly changed. Fortunately, nobody was hurt in this crash.
As you can see, this is the closest one can get to a way a bird would feel in flight. You're completely in the open, the wind in your face, the ground below, and an ever-inviting cloud-filled sky above.
6 years ago, only 2 or 3 people were flying. Today, the figures are about 10,000, and the sport is still on the increase.
With so many people involved in the activity of this nature, safety is an imminent problem. Anyone interested in flying should contact a reputable dealer or a knowledgeable pilot. The sport is safe when done properly and can be very enjoyable for its participants.
Bob Wills took off from the top of San Jacinto Peak, 8,000 feet above Palm Springs, and flew to the city below. After a flight of 4 miles, he landed in Sambo's parking lot and walked in and ordered a hamburger to go.
With that, we have some films of hang gliding, so hang around.
painted sky, where the clouds are hung for the poet's eye. You may find him if you may find him there on a distant shore, by the wings of dreams, through an open door. You may know him, if you may be, as a page that aches for a word which speaks on a theme that is timeless, and the one God will make for your day. Sing as a song in search of a voice that is silent, and the sun God will make for your way. And we dance whispered voice, overheard by the soul, undertook by the heart. You may know it, if you may know it, while the sand would become the stone which begat the spark, turned to living bone. Holy Sanctus, Sanctus be, as a page that aches for a word which speaks on a theme that is timeless, and the one God will make for your day. A song in search of a voice that is silent, and the one God will make for your way.
What's up? The Oscar race. Hi, I'm Ira Daves. In a recent referendum issued to several randomly chosen classes, the students were asked to choose who they felt deserved the Oscar in the categories of Best Picture, Best Director, Actor, Actress, Supporting Actor, and Supporting Actress. The results of the survey are as follows. For Best Performance by an Actor in a Supporting Role, Jason Miller received 42% of the votes for his portrayal of a Jesuit priest in The Exorcist. John Houseman of The Paper Chase came in second with 28%. Randy Quaid from The Last Detail came in third, followed by Save the Tigers' Jack Guilford and Bang the Drum Slowly's Vincent Gardenias. For Best Performance by an Actress in a Supporting Role, Little Tatum O'Neill led the group by quite a wide margin over second place Linda Blair. Tatum received a strong 54% of the votes, while Linda from The Exorcist had 30%. Candy Clark from American Graffiti came in third, followed by Madeline Kahn of Paper Moon and Sylvia Sidney from Summer Wishes, Winter Dreams. In the category of Best Actor in a Leading Role, Al Pacino was rewarded by the students with a 39% of the votes for his performance of a straight cop in Serpico. Robert Redford came in second place for his portrayal of a 1930s con man in The Sting. Redford received 34% of the votes. Jack Lemmon from Save the Tiger came in third. Marlon Brando followed for his performance in Last Tango in Paris. And finally, Jack Nicholson from The Last Detail finished last. For Best Performance by an Actress in a Leading Role, Barbara Streisand came in first for her performance of a campus radical in the nostalgic love story, The Way We Were. Barbara received 39% of the votes. Second place, Ellen Burstyn from The Exorcist received 22%, followed by Glenda Jackson from A Touch of Class, Marsha Mason from Cinderella Liberty, and finally, Joanne Woodworth from Summer Wishes, Winter Dreams. In the Best Director category, William Friedkin won the majority of votes with a strong 52% for his direction in The Exorcist. George Roy Hill came in second for The Sting, followed by American Graffiti's George Lucas. Ingmar Bergman for Cries and Whispers came in fourth, and Bernardo Bertolucci from Last Tango in Paris ended the group. The Sting received the vast majority of votes for Best Picture of the Year, with 41% of the votes. The Exorcist, which received 27%, came in second place. American Graffiti held a strong third with 25%. A Touch of Class received 5%, and Ingmar Bergman's Cries and Whispers, with just 2%, ended the group. With me are a member of the Academy, Walter Doniger, and Bob Kohler, who will be discussing this year's nominees.
I think to begin, we could probably discuss the referendum and the results. I don't think there are too many surprises. Do you think?
Not really. I'm kind of surprised that Last Tango in Paris didn't do better, because to me it was probably one of the best pictures in the last 30, 40, 50, or 300 years.
It's very conceivable, though, in a high school that not too many students had seen it. I think that was probably more of a reason. I think if it had not been rated X, I think that was a disadvantage.
I think there's a reason why The Sting would win out over Last Tango in Paris, because in a way, Last Tango in Paris has more meaning for someone of my age, mm-hmm. and The Sting would have more meaning for someone of younger age, whether chronologically or perhaps emotionally. Because The Sting, both pictures are essentially an examination of society in different levels and with different intensities. But The Sting is a putting down of the establishment by the con man. The establishment in this case happens to be a powerful gangster with connections in various and higher levels of society. And so there's an appeal and an outright and open appeal of defeating those in control. Whereas Last Tango in Paris deals really with a man who is trying to evaluate the way he has lived his life. He's danced that tango of life according to the beat of the same drummer that everyone else has, but now at this point, as a result of a number of experiences principally started by the death of his wife, he's trying to seek out the beat of a different drummer.
Mm-hmm. Can you really take the Sting that seriously, though? I think the Sting is really pretty much the same, an updated version of the kind of film Hollywood was so proficient at making 20 years ago, the kind that that Ernst Lubitsch would make, where it was a nice, pleasant, divertive film that was nothing more than whipped cream. I don't see, really, I think Last Tango represents more of the new morality, which was more brought about by the younger generation, I think, than your generation. Now, I think, as far as your generation goes, I think you would be in a minority, in your opinion, with Last Tango. But The Sting, we have a film clip, and all the film clips we're showing are courtesy of Universal Studios. The Sting, I thought it was absurd that it was nominated for 10 nominations. We can see this clip now, and I think it's pretty representative of the film.
Yeah.
You in?
Yeah, I think so. I gave the producer a C note. Did you find out the deck?
Mm-hmm. He usually plays with a tally-ho fan or a tally-ho circle. I got you one of each. He likes the cold deck low, eights or nines.
That's nice work, JJ.
$20,000 here.
He's waiting for you in the card room.
Let him wait.
I think with The Sting, what we're talking about, at least I think with The Sting, I think the reason why it was so popular is because of all the slick entertainments that you've got and all the real audience-level films, such as the kung fu films, the blaxploitation films. I think The Sting was a high-class, highly slick, highly divertive entertainment. And I personally don't see any political or social overtones in the film.
I disagree with you completely. See, I think every idea has its time. And in a sense, Nixon has helped make this film a popular film, because I think the kind of corruption and exploitation of ordinary people that's represented by Nixon's actions has its counter in this film, where you see not ordinary people, but people on a much lower level being able to hit back at the establishment, even though he is a big gangster, but he is a gangster with important connections in the upper structure of society. So you see here, again, the underdog is getting back in a society where usually he is depersonalized, has no presence, has no means of acting. Here are these guys, one a drunkard and one a very simple con man who is really at the bottom, defeating one of the most frightening and important men in that area at that time. Mm-hmm. So I think that the response to this picture, though I agree with you that in many ways it's a slick picture and it doesn't go into any great depth, its response is a response to a well-made film about something that people feel about today, though they may not recognize it consciously.
Looking at the other nominations, American Graffiti, we also have a film clip on this. I think, why don't we look at it, and then we can discuss what its overtones were with society and why it was so popular, and why it was so popular with the Academy. Why don't we see that now?
You got it for on high?
Why,
he's doing
JC now.
You go to JC?
Yeah, sir.
Oh, wow, do you know Guy Phillips?
Yeah, sure, I got him in class.
Oh, he's so boss.
How'd you like to ride around with me for a while?
I'm sorry, I can't, I'm going steady.
Oh, come on.
I just can't.
You're just riding around with a bunch of girls. Hey, how about somebody else in there? Everybody else want to go for a ride? Look, you got nothing to fear. I'm as harmless as a baby kid.
Judy's sister will go with you, is that all right?
Yeah, you're Judy, your sister, your mother, anybody, I'll take them all. Listen, we'll go up and stop at that light. It'll turn red time we get there. Right? If you ever get tired of going steady with somebody that ain't around, I'm up for grabs.
With American Graffiti, I think we see the nostalgia at its highest level, also with the Sting, also with the way we were. With Graffiti, it's most blatant, but also Graffiti served as kind of an intelligent diversion as far as movie going went. I think it had definite artistic intelligence behind it, do you think?
No. I don't mean that as blunt, to be as blunt as it sounds. I think it was a lovely little picture. And in many ways, when I began in this business as a writer of dead-end kid pictures and all that kind of thing at Universal, where that picture was made, there were many pictures of that kind made, but they were contemporary at the time. They weren't nostalgia. I think this is a skillfully made nostalgia picture. And I think the reason its appeal is so wide is that it takes us back to a safer time and a safer place when people don't have to deal with kinds of problems that they face today. And so you can look back when you were in high school in the 50s and life was much simpler and you rode around the streets and you tried to find a girl or you didn't find a girl or you wondered what kind of a job you were going to take. That was the major problem. You didn't feel as you feel today that the world is crumbling into under your feet.
Right. But what about the ending minutes of the film where they showed the four men? Interestingly, they didn't show the four girls. They only showed the results of what happened to the four men. One died in Vietnam, one died in an auto crash, one moved to Canada, and the one conformed to society and stayed in his hometown.
Mm-hmm.
That was an injection after the post-Kennedy period. And I think that had a really an effective overtone on what we thought. I don't know, I felt that George Lucas did a beautiful job conveying his own personal boyhood visions, and I think in a way it was not just the general view of what the 50s was like, but what his personal view was like.
I think so, and I think he did a lovely job. But you remember, it was called The Faceless 50s, and it wasn't called The Faceless 50s for no reason at all. It was called that because it was a time of no position. It was only during the 60s, the early 60s, when the Berkeley Revolution began, when the people who incidentally were on television last night with Dick Cavett,
right?
Yeah,
yes.
Marvelous
yes.
show, by
yes.
the way, began to move and to take positions and to say that a society, that now we were in a time in those early 60s when the society was giving us the best that it could, and it wasn't good enough for these people because there was something more they wanted out of life. They didn't know what it was, but they knew that if this was the best, it wasn't good enough. Well, their search was smashed, unfortunately. Mm-hmm. And I think some of the results of the smashing of that search for something better we see in Watergate today.
And also the fact that a film like The Exorcist and A Touch of Class are nominated for Best Picture, possibly. Uh-huh. And the fact that a film like Last Tango in Paris or Cries and Whispers is deeply ignored. I think those two films...
Yeah, well, that's an interesting point. Why was The Exorcist nominated, and why was Last Tango in Paris not? And I think you react to most things by the seat of your pants, and then you have all the intellectual reasons as to why it's so, which you attach to your emotional reaction.
It's always true when you see
a
film.
Now, The Exorcist, I think, is a splendidly made picture. But what does it say? It really says... The devil did it. The devil did it. Whatever happened, this girl wasn't bad. The parents weren't bad. Nobody was bad. Some abstract devil made that girl what she was.
Right.
It's really an abdication of personal responsibility for your life. Now, Last Tango in Paris said something exactly opposite. It says...
Well, it was morality, I think.
No,
I think.
It says you make your own life.
Well, it was more individual, whereas The Exorcist projected its own morality into it. I think we're running out of time.
So I'd like to thank both of you for, being here. And it's really been interesting, very enlightening for me, because I haven't seen very many movies this year. And I just want to say that's been this portion of What's Up.